guys, welcome back to my channel. Thank you for subscribing and becoming a part of our family. You know, I appreciate it. I'm Anna Palomino, aka Anna Novia, and I'd just like to say welcome and thank you for watching. You know, I really appreciate it. Today we're gonna talk about the top six lessons I have learned since becoming a full-time entrepreneur. Already know, and you're new to our family. Well, yes, I am a full-time entrepreneur. Yeah, I thought it was gonna be rainbows over here. I thought this was gonna be like, you know, heaven. I thought, girl, now you're a full-time entrepreneur, you're gonna have all this time to do all these things. You can socialize and have a life, and I don't know, just be your best self. Well, truth is, I have been working non-stop. That's the first false ad, you know, that I had to debunk. You don't actually have more time. You actually have less time if you are passionate about your business. You're going to be working so much more. But you know what? That's not the video today. Today I'm gonna tell you the lessons I've learned. And you know what? Let's just dive right in. The first lesson that I've learned is that you need to figure out ASAP how to stabilize your income. When you're a full-time entrepreneur, you don't have like a steady paycheck coming in. If your employer, your former employer, used to pay you $150,000 every single month, regardless of if you do work or not, that's not the case here. When you are a full-time entrepreneur, your income isn't stable. One month you may make 50 grand, another month you may make a million, the next month you may make 100 grand, and the following month you may make 100 million. Like, it's just so all over the place. So the first lesson I had to really just grab onto and really just learn really quickly is that you have to learn how to stabilize your income. Now, how I stabilize my income, or the first idea I had to stabilize my income, was to find a way to just make sure I get at least a certain minimum amount every month. So for example, you can secure an external contract to make sure that as per this contract, you know, you every month you get $100,000 for doing this or doing that. So basically, you need to have more than one streams of income. You can't just have your business being your only source of income. You have to have multiple sources. So one way to stabilize your income is to secure a contract, as I was saying, an external contract where as per this contract, you get paid 50 grand a month, 100 grand a month, whatever it is, 25 grand. Just make sure you have some additional hustles coming in. Another tip I have for you is that you need to be realistic when assessing your business. So if you have read my book, The Big Bad Book of Everything, you would know that you are not gonna get up, quit your 9-to-5 to become a full-time entrepreneur unless your business is now realizing profit, right? You should have been doing this side hustle, aka your business, from when you had your 9-to-5, get it to a level where it's realizing profit, and then you can resign. So you need to be realistic as to how much your business can pay you. Don't be like, yo, my expenses come up to 150 grand, and you know, my business has potential, I believe it can pay me 150 grand. No, you have to be realistic. You have to be realistic about it. And when you be realistic about a business, in fact, we're going to discuss this later on, but when you be realistic about a business, you need to sort of lean more on the side of a pessimist. So if you know by, you know, the numbers, you're looking at facts that your business can make you $150,000 every month, just work with 100 grand or 120 grand, you know, because in business, things happen all the time. I don't know, but things happen all the time. So you have to lean more towards a pessimist in order to not get what a duck gets, you know, at being a full-time entrepreneur. But yeah, so the first lesson I learned was I had to find a way to stabilize my income. Had to. And then instead finding a way to stabilize my income, I had to decide what my minimum income per month had to be. So when I find out what the minimum income had to be per month, I then found a way to make this money consistently every single month. It's not dependent on sales. It's not dependent on the mood of any one person. You just have to make sure that happens, because again, if you don't stabilize your income, one month, honey, you will be able to pay your bills, and the next month you will not. JPS will come look for you. Not even come look for you. JPS just lock off the light. Just so. You know, so to avoid that, just make sure you find a way to stabilize your income. Next lesson that I had to learn, and it was a really big lesson for me, because if you know me in person or you've been watching my videos long enough, you sort of get an idea as to what my personality is like. But a big struggle I had was, you see, after I resigned from Sagicor, it was as if I went from being super busy to just idle. Like, I had all this time, right? And it was weird because when I was at Sagicor, I had Sagicor, yes, and I had my businesses. And so when I resigned from Sagicor, I still had these businesses. So it was weird that I still had all this time. So you know what I ended up doing? I ended up starting more things, doing more things, and writing books and more books, because I wrote a BBB while I was at Sagicor. But I wrote another book, and then I designed a journal, and then I was doing the Money Society, and then I was doing this part of the Money Society, and then I was doing private coaching, and then, like, all these things started happening. And then even things that I don't mention on here, businesses I don't mention on here, I ended up starting, and, like, it was just so much. I ended up ruining my brain. I like to say it's like I wrecked my brain. So the lesson I had to learn, a big lesson, was I had to learn how to be focused. I had to learn how to be focused. I had to figure out what I really wanted. I mean, I always had a vision for my life and I always had goals, but now that I have all this time and all these things going on, I had to figure out what was truly important to me, what I needed to get done, and I needed to be focused on these things. So for the first couple of months after I resigned from Sagicor, I was like a headless chicken. I was always busy, super busy, because I was doing all these different things. But then I had to learn how to get focused. So instead of you spreading yourself thin and you're delivering probably 50% of you on all these different things, get focused and try to give 100% of yourself on everything that you're doing. For you to be able to do that and not crash, you have to reduce the amount of things you're doing and you have to be focused. So I had to learn that. That was a big lesson for me. So if you're going to become a full-time entrepreneur, that's something that you need to look out for. You're going to feel like you have all this time. You probably even act on it. You probably even be out all this time, every minute out, or drink drinks with friends and catch up. But, or you may be like me, you just have all this time, so you don't like being idle, so you just do all these things. But at the end of the day, in either situation, you're not maximizing your true potential, which means that you're not delivering on the things that are truly important to you. So you have to make sure you are putting in the work on the things that are truly important. Yeah, so the next lesson I had to learn was that, yeah, so when you're employed, like on a 9-to-5 type of basis, your employer takes out your pension for you. Know that you're self-employed, like you are a full-time entrepreneur, you have to pay your you have to take out your own pension. You have to make sure your pension is paid and all of these things. Just like your health insurance, your employer probably gave you health insurance while you're employed. But now that you don't have an employer, you're gonna have to make sure you take out your own health insurance, make sure you have your own pension, make sure they're all paid up to date, because now you're sort of like a big girl or a big boy, so you have to do it on your own. Now, side note, as it relates to health insurance, people ask me all the time if I think it's necessary. I think it's necessary if you go to the doctor a lot. So if you're a sickly person, one. Two, if you're not sickly but you wear glasses, that would be a good safe bet for you. If you're a woman, you should be getting your pap smear. You should be seeing the doctor like at least every 6 months. You should be getting your teeth clean and you should be going to the dentist at least every 6 months. So if you are all about doing the things that you should be doing, then a health card can work out for you. So yeah, so now that I'm a full-time entrepreneur, I had to sort these things out for myself. You know, when I was at Sagicor, Sagicor did pension for me, Sagicor did health insurance for me. But now that I'm on my own, I had to make sure I did them on my own, which I did my pension like maybe the first month after I resigned. And then I did health insurance a couple months after. So yeah, but if you're going to become a self-employed entrepreneur, a full-time entrepreneur, these are the things that you need to look out for, not to mention tax. Now, another thing I had to learn, another lesson I had to learn in becoming a full-time entrepreneur is I had to learn how to, and this is a little bit complicated, but I had to learn how to remove my emotions from my business is. And I know it sounds weird, like, you want me to just be a soulless, lifeless person operating my businesses? Well, no, that's not what I'm trying to say. I'm saying that I get so passionate about my businesses. I get so just wrapped up in it that when my businesses are up, I am up. Me, Anna, as a person, I am up. You know, my health is at its finest. I'm in the gym, I'm working out, blood pressure low, skin clean, like all these things. But when my businesses are down, when they have taken a hit or something, then, you know, put on weight, no more gym, like headache every day, round the clock, migraine, all these sorts of things. I had to learn how to separate the two persons, separate the business from me, separate my companies from me, so they don't affect my health, they don't affect my well-being. I had to learn that, because as I said, I'm super passionate about everything I do now. I've said this in several videos, the businesses that I have now are things that I want to be doing, not things that I have to be doing. So because I want to be doing them, and I am an overachiever, you know, that I give like 150% on each of them. And, you know, obviously if you see something not working out that you're so passionate about, you tend to get down on yourself, but you have to learn how to remove that. Because let me tell you, honey, in this world of business, this up and down thing is like the only thing that is certain. The only thing that is certain in business is uncertainty. So you have to learn how to just separate your health and your wellness, your well-being, from the stability of your business. So I had to learn that. Another lesson, and the final lesson I had to learn, was I had to learn to assess failure more than I did success. And this was particularly difficult for me because obviously all these lessons were difficult for me, but this one was difficult for me too. And it's because I am inherently a positive person. I don't like looking at things that have gone bad, or dwell on things that have gone bad, I should say, and be like, oh, I have this regret, that regret, or, you know, that's gonna fail. I'm just a positive person. So when I first started in the world of business a couple years ago, I used to just get knocked down emotionally all the time because I used to be so optimistic about my businesses. I used to assess success a lot. Like, I'd sit down and envision just the success of my business or businesses, and I would just feed off of that, right? So whenever, obviously in business, sometimes it won't work out. When it doesn't work out, it hits me emotionally. But worse is that sometimes when things happen in business, but in the past, I wouldn't have foreseen it any at all. So this is the reason why, kids, take note. This is the reason why you assess the failure more than you do the success. So you have to look at ways that this business can fail, or this project. Why would this project fail? You have to dwell almost on what could possibly go wrong. And the reason why you dwell on what could possibly go wrong is you need to come up with a solution. That's the thing. Because as I said, remember I said, you know, the only thing that's certain in business is uncertainty. So when this thing does come up, or when this problem arises, you won't be so stunned that the business collapse and you collapse. It would be a case of, oh, you know, I thought about this problem and here's a solution type of a thing. So that's why I said you'd look at the failures more than you look at, you know, the possible success. You don't have to really look at the success, because if success happens, then great. What are you really looking at? It's important to manifest and just have a vision, visualize what you want your businesses to be. But I think what's even more important is to sit down and just look at ways this business can fail, attack it from now, come up with solutions to problems that are not even there. So when the problems come up, you are fine. You're okay. Your businesses will not just go down into closure. You will be fine. And a sub note I have to that, or I guess, yeah, a sub note I have to that is, just be a little bit pessimistic about your business's returns or your net profit. Just be a little bit pessimistic about it, because one, for me anyway, it drives me even more. If I think my business is gonna do 100,000, I'm gonna put in way more effort because I want to get to maybe say 200,000. So even though realistically my business probably could have done the 200, or was going to do the 200, because I'm now pushing for it to do even more, at the end of the day, it probably produces 400. So I'm pessimistic when it comes to, you know, net profit of my business, because one, it pushes me and drives me to do even better. And second of all, it's always better to under to over budget than it is to under budget. So when you think that your business is going to do $400,000 per month, and so because of that you take on additional staff, because hey, you're supposed to be able to make $400,000, and so you take on staff to bring your expenses up to like $200,000, but really and truly your business does maybe $200,000, you're left with nothing. So I prefer to think that my business is gonna do like $200,000 per month, so I don't take on any additional responsibilities beyond say $50,000 per month. So when a business does do the $400,000, that's great. Oh my god, I have extra cash, whatever shall I do with this money, oh my god, you know, type of a thing. So that's a lesson that I've learned, and actually these are the six lessons that I have learned in business. One, learn to stabilize your income. Two, separate your emotions from your the financial health of your business, or you know, the productivity of your business. Three, remember to take out pension and health insurance. Four, learn how to be focused. Five, be realistic, but almost lean towards being pessimistic, so that you can just preempt the failure, or you can preempt the problems, I should say, not failure. You can preempt the problems so you can solve them from before they even happen. And I just realized that I said six, but really and truly it's five, because I merged health insurance and pension. So it will be the top five lessons I learned in becoming a full-time entrepreneur. So guys, I hope to see you in my next video. Don't forget to like, subscribe, comment, share, comment. You know what? I want you guys to tell me what's the most valuable thing that you have learned from the Anna Novia channel. I want to know what's the most valuable thing that you have learned since you become a part of our family. Let me know in the comment section. I'll try to respond to each and every one of you. I'll try to anyway. So yeah, I'll see you guys in my next video. Bye.